Hey, everybody. Good afternoon. How are you today? I know it's kind of a bummer because the summer is almost over, but what do you say we milk the last bit of joy we can out of this basketball summer? What do you think? Is that a good plan? The 60 days of summer conclude today, and you are here for a treat, an absolute treat. If you like what you see today, then you can go onto the Hoop Hall YouTube page and check out all the conversations I've been fortunate to have over the course of the summer. You can, if you're a podcast person, subscribe to the Legends podcast and listen to conversations just like this. Or you can just choose to book it for next summer. I'll see you next summer at the 60 Days of Summer. 60 consecutive days of family-friendly entertainment right here at the Naismith Memorial Basketball Hall of Fame underneath the watchful eyes of all of the Hall of Famers who've come before. I'm Kyle Belanger, the least important person you'll be staring at for the next 30 minutes, because my guest today is Kara Wolters, one of the great winners in all of basketball history, championships at every level. I'll introduce her in a moment, but for the next 20 minutes, it's just me and Kara. We're gonna get to talk, tell her story. I'm gonna throw her lobs, she's gonna dunk them. After that, it's your turn. So we'll be selecting a few of you. If you wanna ask a question of a gold medalist, a WNBA champ, an NCAA champ, you can have that opportunity as well. We'll choose a handful of you. And after that, Kara is gonna head over to that table on my right and your left and sign an autograph for each and every one of you. A quick note before we bring her out, the center court is gonna close today at 2:30. So as soon as we are done here, we'll reopen and you can get your shots back up, but let's get to the fun. Kara Wolters is an NCAA champion on the historic 1995 UConn team. She's a WNBA champ with the historic Houston Comets in 1999. She's a two-time Big East tourney most outstanding player, a four-time gold medalist for Team USA, including the 2000 Sydney Olympics. And like I said, she is one of the vanguard of the modern women's sports era. Please put your hands together and welcome Kara Wolters.
You make me sound exciting when I'm not. I like that. Hi, everybody. I'm going to sit now, but yeah. I'm very tall. The first question people ask me, how tall are you? I'm 6'7", so, but now I'm going to sit. I don't look 6'7 when I sit. So I used to, when I was in college and, you know, trying to date the guys, I'd be at like a bar or something sitting down and they'd come up to me and start flirting and then I'd stand up and they'd be like, whoa, okay, didn't realize you were that tall. But, you know, it is what it is. I'm all legs, so when I sit, I'm short.
I sadly am neither all legs nor tall.
Oh, Kyle.
I'm all torso and it expands this way,
oh, yeah,
not
right.
This way anymore.
That's what happens when you're a dad.
When you get to our, oh my gosh, yeah. It's amazing.
Yeah.
So you're from a basketball family.
And yes.
And it's not just, sometimes I say that to the players and the luminaries that I talk to, and it's like, dad coached a little bit here and there, but your mom scored 50 in a high school game.
Look at you.
I did some homework.
She still holds the record at Wellesley High School for most in a game. And she would tell my dad all the time, you didn't score 50 in a high school game. So yes.
But your dad was drafted in the NBA.
He was. And he played for Bob Cousy at Boston College. So that's pretty cool that he played for the Cougs. And they recently honored his team back in the day. Bob wasn't there. He's had some illnesses. But to be coached by one of the greats, and he holds a rebounding record at Boston College. I still think he had 22 rebounds in a game. Yeah, ridiculous, right?
Wow.
And he used to, oh, you didn't get the rebounding gene, clearly. Like, I used to hear that from my dad. So I wasn't as good as a rebounder. So, but I come from good pedigree, I guess.
Yeah.
And it was hard sometimes. You know, you had this pressure and you had this, dad was so good and I wanted to be like him. And that was our time together. And I have a older brother and an older sister. And they played a little bit, they dabbled, but they weren't, you know, that good. And my husband asked my dad once, how did you know Kara was different than the other kids, like was really going to be into it? And he said, the difference was when I came home from work, I would go ask the other kids, do you want to shoot hoops? With Kara, she was at the front door with the basketball going, Dad, let's go shoot hoops, change your clothes, let's go.
Yeah.
So he knew the difference. And that was my time with my dad. And I just loved, because he actually knew the game. So him coaching me was a great thing. There were times after games where you go, all right, Dad, I don't want to hear it anymore.
Right.
But at the same time, he made me, you know, the player and the person that I am. So I'm very grateful. Very grateful.
And then I'm also curious too, because when I think about this era, this is, you know, you and I are roughly the same vintage, and
that means old.
But we're like wine. It's like a good vintage.
Fine wine, you know?
It was a good vintage for people.
Yes, we'll go with that.
And so when I think about, like, you know, there are 23-year-olds who've been alive and they've never been alive without the WNBA.
That is interesting, right?
Right?
Yeah.
So that means that there are several players in the league who've never been alive without that as a career path.
That's interesting.
And that was not the case for you.
No, it wasn't.
And so when Gino, a young Gino Auriemma, starts making the trip out to the Boston area to talk with Mom and Dad Wolters and young Kara Wolters, there was something special that was brewing there. There was, you know, Rebecca Lobo and Jen was about to be there with you, Jen Rosati and Jamel. But there's still, there wasn't this dynasty yet.
Right.
So what does a young Gino Auriemma say to you to keep you in New England and to go to Storrs, Connecticut?
He is one of the best recruiters and motivators out there.
Yeah.
With him, it's not even about the X's and O's. He knows how to motivate people, and he knows how to get the best players together, not necessarily the most talented, but who's going to work together, who's willing to play a certain role.
Sure.
And he's really good about kind of finding that group that'll have that chemistry. I had played AAU basketball with her, but not in the same team, but she was in the same program as me. So I had always kind of grown up idolizing Rebecca, seeing her play all the time. And I wanted, I'm 6'7", but I'm not the most athletic. So I had to kind of outwork people, and I was big and slow and out of shape. And I actually had Boston College, where I thought I would go because my dad went there and I grew up going to games, basically tell me I was too much of a project, but I was welcome to try out as a walk-on at their team. So Gino, thankfully, saw something in me.
Yeah.
And he said, later on I said, what was it that you saw? And he said, you had great hands and great feet, and you were tall, and you can't teach height. And I know you had a really good attitude, and I liked the way you treated your coach and your teammates. So I knew I could teach you, you know, a jump shot or that sort of thing. But he saw those core things in me and took a chance. Honestly, he took a chance on this big, big, gawky, not athletic girl. And so his gamble paid off, and extremely good motivator. I actually, after his home visit, followed him out to the car and said, yes, I want to go to UConn. He's like, whoa, go talk to your parents about it. I'm like, no, I want to go there. He's like, talk to your parents. I'll call you on Monday. So, I basically followed him to his car. Yeah,
that's amazing.
So that's the story of how I went to UConn.
Instead of retweeting, back in the 90s, instead of retweeting, we would just follow people to their, there was no social media.
No tweeting, no Facebook.
Just follow them and
just follow him to his car and tell him. There's no announcement, you know what I mean? There's these kids now have these big announcements, signings. You know, I think I signed it on top of a car and went off to school. So these kids make everything so big.
It's grandiose, yeah.
I mean, come on, you can't have everything like that. You gotta take it in stride. And I was very humble and very grateful for my opportunity. And but I will tell you a story about one of my first practices at UConn. So here I am following Gino Auriemma out to his car because he's a fantastic recruiter. And I go and I'm like so excited to play. So one of my first practices as a freshman, he kicks me out. He says, get out. I said, what do you mean? And he goes, you didn't come here to practice today. You're not ready. You're wasting my time. Get out. And I was like, oh my gosh, welcome to UConn. Is he serious? So I walk outside. Now, Ray Allen was there at the time. And I walk outside the doors of Gamble, and I'm looking in. And Ray walks by and he's like, what are you doing? And I go, well, he kicked me out. Do you think this is one of those tests? He wants me to come back in and be like, coach, I'm ready now. And Ray was like, I would go to the locker room and shower if I were you, but go ahead, you can try it. And so I walk back in the door and I say, coach, I'm ready to play. I can't, I turned it around, I'm ready to play. He said, I said, get the bleep bleep out and chuck the basket. I can't handle this.
Yeah, yeah.
And to me, that was the biggest thing about going to UConn was Gino pulling out of me things that I never thought I had inside me. And a lot of that's mental.
Yeah.
The mental part of the game, there's so much to it. If you can be mentally strong, it's just as good as having a good jump shot. Mm-hmm. So that mental aspect of take the message, but not how it was given.
Sure.
You know what I mean? So to be able to not cry or get down on yourself. I actually did, though, after that, go into his office and say, I can't take it. You're always yelling at me. What is the problem? He said, Kara, you should worry the day I don't yell at you, because that means you have no potential and you're no good to me.
Touché.
And I was like, you must really like me, because yeah. You're yelling at me all the time. But that kind of made me realize, like, okay, it's not, I can't take it personally. I have to take it as motivation and coaching. And that's why he's one of the best coaches around, and I'm blessed to have played for him.
And so in 95, your team, both UConn and Tennessee, change basketball that year.
Yeah.
35-0 UConn. You beat Coach Pat Summitt and Tennessee in one of the most impactful games in basketball history.
Yeah.
In Minneapolis, I mentioned it before, right? You, Rebecca, Jen Rosati, Jamel. I mean, like, it was that roster top to bottom reads like a who's who. What is the one thing about that team that you wish people talked about more?
Ooh, that's a good question. Well, on paper, we were not the best team in the country, okay? If you looked at our roster, a bunch of unathletic girls, and on paper, we weren't supposed to win that. But the thing about it was we just had a chemistry and a love for each other, and we were fundamentally sound, you know? I think nowadays everything's showboat and who can go one-on-one, and we didn't care who the star was. So we were very unselfish players, and Gino taught us the second we stepped on campus, it's not all about you. We're going to move on with or without you. So I just think the chemistry and the people on that team, the people were just good people that cared about the game of women's basketball and not about who's going to score 30 points in the national championship game.
Right.
Although I did have 31 in the semifinals against Stanford. But that's not what I just think the people, the stories of the people, I think, are more important than necessarily winning. Although I am grateful, I feel like we kind of started the snowball rolling down the hill and it's just gotten bigger and bigger.
Yeah,
so to be a part of history and kind of how it started, not only for UConn, but for women's basketball, I'm grateful, but there's a lot of good people that spend a lot of time working hard for each other to help change the game.
You know, you're also part of, as I mentioned in your intro, there are few people who are part of and major contributors on more historical rosters than you, because your 2000 Olympic team that you alluded to as well, I mean, that roster, maybe 95 UConn wasn't super athletic and the most talented. That 2000 team in Australia,
they were
you,
right.
Rebecca.
No, Rebecca wasn't on that team.
Oh, that's right.
No, she was in 96.
That's right. This was Lisa Leslie, Cheryl Swoops,
Dawn
Teresa
Staley.
Edwards, Dawn Staley.
Yeah.
it's bananas to think about. So how do those, and you, of course, you start your international experience in 96. This was a really big moment for you as your game develops, as you move towards a professional career.
Yeah.
What did those rosters and those teams teach you about your game professionally?
I have a lot of work to do.
Yeah.
You go to work every day with those greats, Therese Edwards, 5-time Olympian, all these people. I felt blessed and like a sponge, like, teach me. Yeah. I want to learn. I'm very coachable. I'm just amazed that I get to play with these people. But I don't think I was necessarily one of the 12 best players in the world. Honestly, I was a player that was unselfish, that knew my role and knew that I was willing. And it's hard. You come from UConn where you're the leading scorer and the star and whatever. And then you go to these USA basketball teams and you're just one of many talented people.
Yeah.
So you have a choice where you can either get down on yourself and be like, oh, well, I'm not going to play a lot, or choose to go to practice. I'm going to kick Lisa Leslie's butt every day in practice to get her prepared to start against Australia and earn myself minutes. So I remember Nell Fortner was our coach on the Olympic team. And the Olympics aren't just like you try out one day and if you have a good day, you make the team. It's years and years of playing USA basketball. And I was the last one named to the Olympic team. Now, they were slowly naming people to the team. And I remember, so the team would have a break, say, for a week. And I wouldn't go home. I would go to Orlando and train with a strength and conditioning coach because, again, I was big but not athletic. But I had to outwork people.
Yeah.
And so I'd go to Orlando and train with the strength and conditioning coach. And I remember Therese Edwards, right, of all people, she said, big girl, they put you on this team yet? And I said, no, not yet. And she goes, I wouldn't take one more step on that treadmill until they put me on the team. And I said, Therese, I'll do whatever it takes to represent our country. And I'd be second string water girl if I could represent our country in the Olympics. And Nell Fortner, we were training at the Olympic Training Center in Colorado Springs. And she said, who in this room would be willing to play 1 minute if that's all I needed to win a gold medal? My hand went up real quick, right? And I think that's kind of the day that solidified my spot was my attitude and my effort and what I was willing to bring to be around these players and learn from the best in the world. I mean, think about, like you said, who I played with.
Yeah.
Really?
Well, also, they played with you. Let's not forget that, right?
That's
the truth. Now, here's the part I was telling you about. I only have 3 questions left for Kara Wolters. So that means after this question, if you've always wanted to ask a question of a gold medalist, of a WNBA champion, of an NCAA legend, this is your chance. So be thinking about that next, and I'll ask for volunteers after this question. In 99, you're part of yet another dynasty, the Houston Comets, which... For those people who don't understand the place that the Houston Comets have in basketball history, we're talking 4 straight the first 4 WNBA titles. You're there for the 99 title. And it's really the beginning, the beginning, the birth of the WNBA. It started 2 years before. I know you were at a game last night.
Yeah.
Can you talk? So Las Vegas at Connecticut last night, 9,000 screaming fans at Mohegan Sun Arena. It's the best basketball game on across the planet last night, bar none.
Yeah.
Talk about those early days playing for a juggernaut Houston Comets team, and then maybe compare that to what we saw last night.
Played with greats like Cynthia Cooper, Cheryl Swoops. Played for Van Chancellor. He used to say, Biggins, this is what we're going to do today, Biggins. I was like, all right, welcome to Houston. So again, being part of that. Now, I started in the ABL, which was a league before the WNBA. We actually played during the regular basketball season. So not many people kind of remember that league. Played in that league. And then it folded and we were dispersed in the WNBA draft. So I was dispersed to Houston Comets. And again, I knew I was coming into a situation with legends, right? So I'm like, oh, here we go again. Some of the best in the game. But there was a trend.
Let's share.
All right. I'll take yours. I'll give it back. So to be part of that dynasty and knowing you're going into it, again, you have to have the mindset is I'll do whatever it takes to help this program. And huge what they started. I'm part of, again, this history of a game now at this level. Now I go to the game last night, which you were at, and it's I like it because the people in the league appreciate the people that came before them to set it up for what happened last night. So even though some of these women don't know me, they will come up to me and say, Kara, like they do know me. So they appreciate the history of the WNBA. Now the game has changed a lot. It's gotten a lot faster, a lot quicker, a lot more physical. Last night there was a lot of banging in there. I was like, but part of me was like, ooh, I want to go in there because I like that. I miss that. But part of me is like, wow, the game has changed quite a bit. But to be part of the history of the league and have these youngins appreciate what we did to kind of pave the way is a pretty great thing. Yeah, I got to tell you this story real quick. Aces coach, Bill Laimbeer, okay? He was like one of the greats, obviously, in the NBA, and people used to boo him in the NBA. Now they boo him when he comes out, and he just kind of waves to him. I kind of like his attitude. Kelly Schumacher, who played at UConn, is an assistant coach for the Aces. Her husband is a strength and conditioning coach for LeBron James and travels with him. It's his personal coach, goes everywhere. And Kelly said that LeBron came to one of the Aces games in Vegas last week, and it was him and Chris Paul and someone else. Awesome. So it was halftime, and they were, you know, the coaches come back out. There's like 2 minutes of warm-ups left before the game starts, and LeBron James runs over to the bench to give Kelly a hug because he knows Kelly because of the husband, and gives Kelly a big hug, and he's like, sorry, we're leaving before the end of the game. I wanted to give you a big hug. So he runs over, and then he runs back to his seat. And Bill Laimbeer turns to Kelly Schumacher and goes, are you kidding me? He didn't want to come say hello to me. I'm Bill Laimbeer. I started some of this in the NBA, and he couldn't even have the decency to say hi to me. So there's mostly a respect for the players that come before you in the WNBA for sure. LeBron made a bad choice doing that, but I'm sure Bill Laimbeer will say something to LeBron about that. But in the WNBA, anyway, there's a great respect for the older players.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So do you have a question for Kara Wolters? Put your hand in the air right now, and one of my friends in the Hoop Hall staff will come by and select a few of the hands raised. Now,
your
participation in hoop doesn't just stop when your playing career ends. People still, you know, you do broadcasting.
Yes. I work for Sports New York, SNY, and I'm the in-studio analyst for the UConn women's games.
And you make it look so natural. That's the thing. Was this always a natural thing for you, or did someone have to coach you through that too? Because the way you come through the screen is remarkable.
Aw, thanks. No, I'm just real. I'm just myself. Yeah. Maybe I have a little Charles Barkley in me as far as, like, I tell it how it is
you
when
do.
We're up there. But I have such a love for the game and such a respect for the game and the people that are playing. It's just fun. And to get to stay around the UConn program and Gino, although I'm not at the games because I'm in studio in New York where our studios are at the World Trade Center, I still go to practices. So there's always that connection. And talk about players have a respect. All the UConn Huskies, once a Husky, always a Husky. You go back there, and Chris Daly actually quizzes the freshmen in the beginning of every year history of UConn basketball. So they have such a respect. If you walk in a gym, the current players will come over, give you a hug, say thank you. I mean, he has set that up on purpose, obviously. So he's not only built a basketball team, but a dynasty of a program and the type of people that belong to that.
That's the way something gets woven into the fabric, right?
Yes.
You can wipe away some, but if it's in the fabric, it'll never leave.
It's true.
So my final question for you, Kara, of all of the accomplishments, and we only scratched the surface, I could have just read your resume for 20 minutes and I wouldn't have gotten
it. We could talk forever,
right?
Yeah, this is fun.
I feel like this could work.
Yeah, this could work.
We need to get someone, if anyone's watching and wants to put this on the air. This moment, like this actual moment, you've been here so many times, you live so nearby, and yet every time you come into the Hall of Fame and look up at those eyes looking down at us, and you see a new set of fans who've driven this way, this distance to see you, what is this moment like for you right now? Can you put that into context?
You're a natural at this too.
Oh, thank you.
It, like you said, it never gets old. I look up And to think that I mentioned I was inducted into the Women's Basketball Hall of Fame 2 years ago, but to just think that you're mentioned among these people,
yeah.
Talk about respect, much respect to the people who started all this. So it doesn't get old when I walk in here, and when I'm asked to come here, I'm like, me? Really? Because you have a lot of people you could choose from. So I'm grateful, and I love every time I step into this building. It's just, I'm grateful to be mentioned in the same breath as some of these people.
Ladies and gentlemen, Kara Wolters.
Yeah.
This is such an honor. Thank you.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Thank
so
you.
So let's get to the hard question, because I was just throwing you lobs. You were, and I have a funny feeling we got a hard question right now. So let's bring on our audience question.
Oh boy.
And I, you know what? Katie, take a seat.
Oh. All right, Katie, come on down. How are you? Nice to meet you.
So I was wondering, your legacy. How do you feel about inspiring young girls? With the gender differences between the WNBA and the NBA, how difficult it is to, you know, shine through.
Mm.
What would you tell those young girls?
Oh, great question. I have the opportunity to coach an AAU program. So I coach a sixth grade team. My daughters are in fifth and sixth grade. So I get to see it, and I get to be around and hopefully impact the youth. The thing that I try to teach them more than the X's and O's are the things like Gino taught me. You learn lessons of life about discipline and hard work and teamwork and all those things. To me, if I can teach those in fifth and sixth grade that I didn't really get until college, until I played for somebody like Gino, to me, that's one of the biggest gifts you can give them, and not just for putting a ball in a basket, for life. And I teach them about, you know, I think losing is a really important part of childhood. And I feel like parents these days, they don't want to let their kids fail. And I think it's important to fail, because that's how you learn and you come back from that. So I actually we'll set up tournaments where I'll say, let's play a higher grade, let's lose. AAU to me is not about the parent that thinks their kid's going to UConn or any of that craziness. It's about failing, it's about recovering, it's about mentally being tough, and not everybody gets a trophy in life, and I feel like some of this generation grew up learning that, and I'm there to tear it all down and tell them not everybody gets a trophy in life, kid, in the nicest way possible. Body language is really important to me, and I see a lot of these kids with negative body language, and I hate that. You need to be proud of yourself, be able to fail, dust yourself off, and come back. I had a lot of people, doubters and non-believers in my life. People that said, there's no way you'll play anywhere. You're tall, but you're big and you're slow. And I had so many people tell me I can't do it. So if I can make an impact on one kid, and I also run basketball camps, and we have, you know, 200 kids go through basketball camp, if they go away with learning how to shoot a jump shot, great. But if they can go away with that positive attitude, body language, you treat people a certain way, you do things a certain way, be confident. Everyone's got their thing. You know, my daughters are over there, and they're like me. They're not blessed with athleticism, but they are blessed with height. And my one daughter says to me, Mom, I'm last at every sprint I take, and it's really, she gets sad about it. And I said, I'm going to write a book called I Was Last at Every Sprint I Ever Took My Whole Life. It's true. You have to find what you're good at and your strength, and not compare yourself to other people. Because you know what? I was last at every sprint I ever took, and I'm a gold medalist. So it's okay to fail. It's okay to be, as long as you try hard and you're working, the tall people usually are the last at the sprints, and the quick guards are, you know. So find the thing that you're good, work on the things you're not great at, but find your thing. And know that you bring something special to every, whether it's a basketball game, whether it's anything at school. Everybody has their talent. And don't compare yourself to other people. So sorry, I could talk all day long. Thank you, Katie.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Katie. Sorry, I'm a talker.
No, that was fantastic. And thank you for the question, Katie. Ladies and gentlemen, one last round of applause for Kara Wolters.
Hey, this little one has a question.
Oh, bring it up. Let's do this.
Let's do this thing. Come on, girl.
Well, I mean, I can't give Katie the seat and not you, right?
Yeah. You got it. What's your name?
Avery.
Avery, nice to meet you. I'm Kara.
Nice to meet you.
How old are you, Avery?
I'm 10.
10. Okay. School starts soon?
Yeah.
Are you ready?
Yeah.
What, fifth grade?
Yeah.
All right. Big time now. Okay. Fifth grade. All right. What do you got for me?
What were your motivations for playing basketball? Like, why did you want to play?
Oh, great question. Honestly, my father and my parents were my role models. They were my motivation. I grew up in a basketball family. I was the youngest of four. I was a gym rat, so I was always dragged to games and things, and I just loved the game. And you know what? I also loved that it was a place that I felt like I belonged. Because of my height, it's hard growing up. Kids are mean, right? They'll find anything to pick on you for. So I was picked on because of my height. And I felt height was where my, you know, basketball was where my height was looked upon as a positive. And I liked feeling like I belonged to something. So it started with my family being my motivation. And then I loved the camaraderie, my friends that I got to play with. And it was a positive for my height. So I found a place that I fit in. So those were some of my motivations for basketball.
Thank you.
That's a great question.
Nice to meet you.
Nice meeting you.
Excellent question.
10 years old. That's not easy to do.
That's
good
not.
Good job, Avery. Good job.
I don't mind saying this. Anyone else have a question?
Anyone? Anyone?
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, Kara Wolters.
Thank you guys for listening.
You were amazing.
All right. Thank you. I will sign some autographs now.
Yes. Okay. Now, Ms. Wolters is heading over to the table on our right and your left. So if you want to follow the instructions of my friends in the Hoop Hall staff, they'll put you in the correct line. One autograph per person. And if you want to limit the photos to when, you know, you don't want a selfie while you're up there. We want to make sure Kara has a chance to chat with everyone.